Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As Mr. Shivkumar said, I'm from the school and I really don't know what I'm doing here. And at the end of what I have to say, I think I'm going to be very unpopular with the ICT section people and those who are trying to promote a lot of ICT in schools, because yes, there's a lot that I had prepared that I would say. There is so much that ICT can do and so much it can do for higher education, but what I am going to talk about is purely from the perspective of a school teacher, and more so from the perspective of a school teacher who impacts the minds of little children. And I'm going to give you a different aspect, a different belief, which a lot of people in the Western world, as well as all over, have started now believing in. So while ICT is such a necessary skill, like Alvin Toffler, the futurist, said, the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. There's no denying the fact that ICT can aid education and thereby the development of a society. What is significantly challenging is the unpredictability of the knowledge and the skills that a person will require 20 years from now. Therefore, the question that needs to be addressed is, what do our students need to learn today to be prepared for tomorrow? And in order to answer that, we need to realize that there has to be a shift from an industrial mode of schooling to one that focuses on equipping students for a knowledge economy, for providing them with the ability to seek, to synthesize, and to critically think about the over-expanding volumes of information that is available to students, as well as to simply acquire knowledge. And therefore, IT in school education has two roles to play. One is teaching IT as a subject in the school, and the second is using IT in the school as a tool for teaching as well as learning. Now, research shows that we are not doing very badly in India as far as teaching of IT as a subject in schools or colleges is concerned, but what we teachers really face a problem with is how, where, how much of IT should we use in our day-to-day teaching. Because the variety of software that comes into the market today is ever increasing every day. Would a national policy help? What do we do? Can we have uniformity? Much change is happening in the curriculum, and in most institutions there's a strong emphasis on constructivism and learning by doing. In fact, today some educationists redefine an educated person as one who has the knowledge and can think critically to convert his thought into action and influence, and also have the ethics to use that influence for the good of society. IT undoubtedly is a boon, but experience shows us that none of these, you know, ICTs cannot really replace the teacher in the classroom. In fact, the introduction of ICTs in the classroom, the teacher's role in the learning process becomes more critical. As learning shifts from a teacher-centered model to a learner-centered one, the teacher becomes less of the sole voice of authority and more the facilitator, mentor, coach, and moves on from sage on stage to be a guide on the side. The primary task of the teacher becomes to teach the students how to ask questions and pose problems, formulate hypotheses, locate information, and then critically assess the information found in relation to the problems posed. In fact, teachers who are also new to ICTs become co-learners and discover new things along with their students. It is not uncommon to see a reversal of roles where a student leads an adult to new learning outcomes. Yet many teachers are reluctant to use ICTs. The reasons, according to research, can vary from poor software design to the fear of losing their authority in the classroom. Increased time in learning to handle technology and effort needed to equip oneself with the requisite skills are deterrents too. These are all issues that must be addressed by both pre-service and in-service training and professional development programs. As Minister Kapil Sibal has put it, there has to be a complete change in the mindset of the teachers. I'd like to point out, like I was saying, a difference in thinking in the present day scenario. There's no gainsaying the importance of ICTs in education. However, many educationists today believe that overexposure to technology at a very early age and bombardment with too many visual aids or intellectual abstractions can impair the natural development of the child's intellectual growth. Two important aspects of any kind of learning are memorizing and understanding. Both are almost equally important at a later stage of application. Certain amount of memorization cannot be avoided, whether it is to do with science and technology or any other subject. And technology reaches, and how many new gadgets come into the market? On the other hand, some concepts should be taught with aids. It is also a reality that some children find it difficult to grasp or to understand certain concepts. They find it difficult to comprehend certain phenomena in three dimension, or working and movement of dynamic objects in abstract forms, or when depicted in two-dimensional forms. In those cases, a three-dimensional form or a virtual working model is useful. In junior classes, the solar system or the atomic structure, the bonding of atoms for a chemical reaction, the digestive system, these are the kind of concepts that can be handled by the teacher easily, and the pupil can see it vividly if there is an appropriate external aid. Actually, quite a few difficult concepts can be taught in the class by talking and by using simple two-dimensional diagrams on the board or charts and graphs. A lot can and should be left to the imagination and the visualization of the pupils. Usage of too many aids from early stages does not serve the purpose. It stints the development of imagination, visualization, and the abstract thinking in children. Certain concepts can and should be taught practically by sensory methods at every age. One has to actually take a nature walk with an adult to experience the look, feel, and smell of a freshly growing tender leaf and a dried withered leaf. The virtual world cannot replace the actual world or replace the necessity of teachers, the human touch. Empathy and unconditional love from the teacher, the adults, mothers go a long way in the development of a child. Every child needs somebody for motivation, sharing the sadness and the joy for normal growth of the EQ and the SQ. One of the worst things you can do for a child's self-esteem is to let them give up. On the flip side, there's nothing better for building confidence than learning that you can do something you thought you couldn't. The computer is especially a boon for helping such teachers and students. I have serious reservations about using the same teaching aid for every kind of child. Only when a child fails to understand and is about to give up should the teacher take the help of external aids. It deprives children from trying, visualizing, and imagining. In the orthodox systems, there's a large scope for imagination, visualization, exploration, for trial and error. A good teacher customizes his teaching technique to suit different students with different learning styles. Now, the assessment shows huge investments that the West has made in technology for education has almost entirely failed to deliver any desirable improvement in the learning outcomes. The reason is that majority of the technology has been designed to reinforce and legitimate 19th century education practice. So technology is being used to support teaching and not learning. To take that further, when we talk about online learning, we actually mean digitalization of old teaching material. It is like reading a book on an iPad, but it is still reading a book. There can be There can be economic and environmental advantages to the digital mode, but it does not change the learning experience. I'd like to draw your attention to a recent article in the Indian Express titled "A Silicon Valley School That Doesn't Compute." The article quotes the examples of children of employees of the Silicon Valley, of the Silicon Valley giants like Google, Apple, Hewlett-Packard, etc., sending their own children to a Waldorf school which endorses no usage of any technological gadgets till the child is in 8th grade. According to Waldorf philosophy, only at this stage is the child prepared to exercise pure, abstract, formal, logic, symbolic thinking. Before then, it damages a healthy and balanced development. They believe that to be able to put the computer in an adequate perspective in education or in individual or social life, it is necessary to understand very well what it is. Since the computer acts as a virtual space, the space of thoughts we may insert into the machine, any uses of it forces abstract thinking. This can do no good to a child before his brain is equipped to take it. Hardware may be taught before, as it is not purely virtual as software is. We have to wait until the young person has developed the mental abilities to push for the abstractions and self-control required by any use of computers. In the final analysis, what we need to remember is that the goal of education is to help students realize that they can think, learn, act, and change things. All children are to be educated and schooled in a way that encourages exploration, discovery, and curiosity. While learning ICT can be an important goal in its own right, one of the emphasis on ICT in the curriculum is so that students can learn to use these intellectual tools throughout all disciplines and problem areas that they may encounter. Our education systems should place significant emphasis on people and ICT systems working together in a manner that leads to performance above what either people alone or ICT systems alone can accomplish. With that, I'd like to rest my case. Thank you.